Give the Lord a good praise. Hallelujah. He's good, isn't he? Amen. Welcome to Christmas Sunday. Dove Church. We're glad to have you. We thank God for this Sunday. We thank God for what he's doing for us. We thank God for so many of our people who have come through the COVID and been infected, and now they're walking on the other side of it and are alive to tell the story. And we are thankful today. So we welcome you all here. We are rejoicing in the goodness of the Lord. And he is great toward us. And we recognize him as not just a man, he's God. He's not just a baby, he's king. And he's king to the glory of God. And he's king over all. And he'll be king forever. And when that forever is done, another forever kicks in. Forever and ever. So we're rejoicing today. Today we're going to do part two of the message that we started last week. What's in a name? Well, before that, let's say our confession with your Bibles lifted or wherever your Bible is. Repeating after me, this is my Bible. I am who it says I am. This book calls me an overcomer, and that's who I am. Today I shall be taught the unchanging Word of God. So my mind is alert, my heart is receptive, as I gladly receive the Word today. I believe that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the entrance of your Word. Not only brings life, but it brings light. We thank you for what we've been sovereignly given. We thank you for how you've been good to us. We thank you for this Word. So we come against everything that's on assignment from trying to stop this Word. And we thank you, God, that it shall go forth with power and effect change in the world. And so, God, we declare it, and we entreat you, Holy Spirit, be with us in this time. And we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. What's in a name? Lesson 2. In our last lesson, just quick review, that's not really a review, but a listing. We told you some key names or significance of Yahweh. We're going to continue that. And number one, Yahweh is self-existent. Self-existent. Then number two, Yahweh is relational. Yahweh is relational. Number three, Yahweh is with us. And number four, Yahweh is unchanging. And starting in number five, Yahweh is holy, and not H-O-L-Y, but W-H-O-L-L-Y, holy, completely. Holy, other than us, different than us. He is holy, different than us. While we want to make him just like us, while we are created in his image, he is still wholly different than us. And we ought to be glad about that. And we ought to remember that God is altogether holy, H-O-L-Y. And holiness is one of those words that people don't want to deal with today. If you start talking about holiness, they'll go to, now you think you holier than thou. It's an affront to people to talk about holiness. It messes with them. But God is holy. He said it about himself in his Word. So, operating from there, Therefore, since we know he is holy, we cannot reduce him to our own personal servant. He is not an ecclesiastical bellboy. He's not the valet that goes get your car. And I'm going to get crazy and say, he's not just the one that gets us our best life now. Or perfect peace and no problems. He is entirely other than you and me. Psalm 50 and 21 in the New Century Version. This verse smacked me right in the face. Psalm 50, verse 21. And it says, I have kept quiet while you did these things. So you thought I was just like you. But I will scold you and accuse you to your face. See, if you take him for granted, he lets you know, oh, you thought I was just like you. But I will scold you and accuse you to your face. People don't want either. But he's a God that will do both. Wow. He isn't like us, but he does relate to us more deeply than we can imagine. Because the parts that is unlike him, he's trying to turn into him and help you become him. He's cleaning up the image day by day. Just allow it. And part of that allowing is to use some abrasiveness. Scolding is an abrasion to something that needs to move. Anybody had to clean a pot and you couldn't get it to move good, and so you put something a little abrasive. In the olden days, we would use a little scouring powder and a scouring pad. We wanted to get the pot back shiny again, and there was some stuff that had gotten burned on a little bit, and so you had to put a little elbow grease with it, but you had to scour it. Really, you were scolding the pot to clean it up. You had to scold it to clean it. They call it scour, but that's what you would do. You're applying some abrasion and rubbing. And sometimes that process doesn't always be good. It doesn't always feel good, but the thing is that it removes the fact that you think, like the scripture say, that God was just like you. He wants it to stay unshiny. Number 6. Yahweh keeps covenant. Yahweh keeps covenant. And let's go back. When he first enters into covenant with Abraham, he promises that he will forever be keeping his word. Amen. Thank you, God. You forever are going to keep your word. We serve a God that's going to keep his word. When he reveals himself again as Yahweh to Moses, he reminds him that he is unchanging and will not go back on his word. Again, God will not stop wanting us. Thank you, Jesus. You will never stop wanting us. He did everything to get us back, and he still wants us. You ought to be glad God wants you. And first he wants you just like you are so that he can scour you and get you to a place that looks more like him than like you. But he wants you. He never stopped wanting you. Amen? Angels fail, but he didn't send Jesus after an angel. He didn't want them. But he wants you. God is a God of covenant. He ties himself to us in agreement. And generally when he ties himself to us, he holds the bigger side of the agreement. All you have to do is participate in the agreement. He sets himself in agreement with you over a set of principles and practices. This is what I expect. Can you do it? Your agreement is simply yes or no. Usually with these simple words, agreements can be long and exhaustive, page after page after page, but it's simple. An agreement is as simple as this. If you will, I will. If you will, I will. Let me say what covenant is. Covenant is a part of your everyday life, whether you like it or not. Let me cite some examples. Your insurance policy is a covenant. It says you will get this amount of money after you die if it stays in force until you die. That's one type of covenant, whole life policy. Then your rental agreement is a covenant. Because if you break the covenant, they're going to go to court. And part of that covenant means I have a right to sit your side of the covenant out on the sidewalk. Your broken side. You sit out there as a reminder that you broke the covenant. And some people thought their car got stolen, but they broke covenant and it was removed. They stole my car. But then when they came to, they thought about something and they said, no, I can't call the police. It's not stolen. You broke covenant. I mean, you know I'm talking right. Your mortgage is a covenant. That's a big covenant. Is either a 30-year covenant or a 15-year covenant. And the covenant comes around, the reminder of the covenant comes around monthly as a payment. It reminds you we're in covenant. And those 30 days come around fast. How many of you know I'm talking right? When you look up, you say, it's that time again. Don't complain. Write the covenant check. Because you're in covenant. You said, if you will, give me this house at X amount of interest rate, I will pay it monthly. And they established the amount. Amen? Amen. Everybody say covenant. Covenant. Well, let me go on and make it a look. Your auto loan is a covenant. And we obscure relational covenants. And in relationships, going together is not covenant. Going together is not covenant. Living together is not covenant. Engagement is not covenant. Marriage is covenant. It pledges all to the other person. There should not be an escape hatch. And that's what sometimes living together, testing, and some just crazy wisdom tries to say, you need to try the shoe on for a while before you buy it. Escape hatch. I see you're not happy with that one. 7. Yahweh is full of mystery, but worth seeking. This is where we're going to spend the majority of our time for the remainder of the message. We worship a God of mystery. But a God that tells us, my ways are not like your ways. So it's mysterious to us how God operates. He tells us to seek him. And sometimes we find him in a place, then he keeps telling us to seek him, and then he's moved. Which means keep looking for me. He's a mystery. He is mystery, mysterious in another sense. He is mysterious through careful reveals. This is the day where people like to do a lot of reveals. Reveals for babies' names. Reveals for what's happening next. Reveals for what we're going to do in our life next. And God is big on reveals. But they're still shrouded in mystery. What is one of the things that's a careful reveal? His plan to get man back into relationship and fellowship with him that will last throughout eternity. It was a plan, but it was done in a series of mysterious activities. Stuff that are hard to understand. Because Yahweh is mysterious. Let me throw something in. God is the only one that can name God. He's the only one that can name God. In the Old Testament, we have his name, but over in the New Testament, all we say is God. But God of the New Testament is not his name. I'm going somewhere. When God planned to send his son into the earth, he sent his name first. He sent his name first. He sent his name first. And here comes the mystery. Isaiah got it, but he didn't get the name. He got the attributes to the name. How do I know that? Isaiah 9:6. Here is a mysterious verse. It said, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His name would be called. These are attributes. Come on. Because we don't get the name until over in the New Testament. So the attributes of the name. And when we get the name, that's when we call him Wonderful. You're my Counselor. You're my Mighty God. You're the Prince of Peace. You're the Everlasting Father, but you got a name. Are y'all out there? So Isaiah gives the attributes that will be later given for the child that will be born of a virgin. Mystery. What? A virgin gonna give birth to a child? A mystery. A mystery that still messes with folk head. A mystery that's still hard for people to believe that somebody can enter the earth realm in an earth suit and not have a physical father, but a physical mother. Come on, don't act like you all good with that, because that messed them up in that day and it messes us up in this day. And the reason why people can't believe it is because it doesn't match their science. And that's why when I do a confession at the end of my message, believe that he you know, I talk about him being raised from the dead, another mystery. But sometimes we allude to the fact that he was born of a virgin. See, that's a part of the salvation thing, that you believe Jesus was born of a virgin. You have to believe that. How many of you believe that? Amen. 700 years after this prophetic announcement, we find the mystery of the plan of salvation unfolding in an unlikely story. An unlikely story. The whole Christmas story is an unlikely story. A virgin birth in a manger, not in the palace of a king. But only in the New Testament do we get the new name for God. Luke 1:26-31. And this name people have a problem with. They want to still pray in the attribute. In the name of the Father. In the name of the Son. In the name of the Holy Ghost. It has a name. He has a name. Luke 1:26-31 says, "Now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin betrothed to a man." She was betrothed. Betrothed means they had not come together sexually. It was the engagement period. An engagement is not the same level as marriage. Betrothed. Whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And having come in, the angel said to her, "Rejoice, highly favored one, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women." I need to stop there. Blessed are you among women. The reason why he said, "Blessed are you among women," is because until that time, every Jewish mother was praying to have a baby boy that would potentially become the Messiah. And so the angel announces to her, "You are blessed among all the other praying women because you're the one." Blessed are you among women. But when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying and considered what manner of greeting this was. Well, that was when she was troubled when she heard the greeting. But oh, baby, the real trouble getting ready to come. You're betrothed to Joseph. You promised to Joseph, but you have not come together sexually with Joseph. Here comes the part that messes her up. Then the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold," I want you to look real carefully. That's what behold means. Look carefully. "You will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son and shall call his name Jesus." What is God's name in the New Testament? He told us. He told us. That's his name. That's his name. Now, how many of you know she was really messed up? Because he rushed on past, "You shall conceive." Whoa, stop. How was this going to be? I have a sensing of what anatomy is. How was this? And then the angel went past there and said, "See, I'm so sure it's going to happen. When he show up, call him Jesus. Call his name Jesus." the Old Testament, the highest name of God given to men by way of Moses was Yahweh or Jehovah, meaning Lord. And then when they asked Moses, who do I say? When Moses asked God, who do I say sent me? He said, I am that I am. I name who I name. I am who I am. I submit to you that the name of God in the Old Testament, Yahweh, is the name of God in the New Testament, Jesus. Because God is consistent. Let's go to Isaiah 45 and 23. Isaiah 45 and 23. And it says there, I have sworn by myself, my God, the word has gone out of my mouth in righteousness and shall not return. And underline this, or whatever way you can make it stand out, that to me, excuse me, every knee shall bow. And every tongue shall take an oath. Another way of saying every tongue shall confess. Confess to what? That I am Lord. Come on. Who is Lord? Yahweh, Jehovah, Lord. Well, you don't believe me yet. Philippians 2, 6 through 11. We're going to find some similar language. And this is Paul talking. And he writes, who being in the form of God did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men and being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, everybody say therefore, from this point forward, God also has highly, everybody say highly, exalted him and given him the in Old Testament he was Adonai, and God said, let us. To Moses he was Yahweh or Jehovah, Lord. But over in the New Testament, and you shall call his name Jesus. God has highly exalted him and given him the name, which is above every name. God can name God. So we get so used to saying God. Well, we don't want to say Jesus. You can't ask me to do an invocation or pray a prayer and not say Jesus. Because my prayer got to move, and it only moves at the name. Something about his name, but it ain't just for singing. It's for utilization. It's to be used in every sphere of your life, every decision. Jesus. Let me read on. That at the name of Jesus, some knees should bow.
Every knee.
How many?
Every.
Of those in heaven, and of those on earth, and of those under the earth, and that every, how many? Tongue should confess that Jesus is Lord to the glory of God the Father. It's Jesus.
Yes.
Hebrews 1, 1 through 4. Just to add something to the name. It said, God, who at various times, in various ways, spoke in past to the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken to us by his Son, who he has appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the world, who being the brightness of his glory. Jesus is the brightness of his glory, because Jesus is God. Come on. When you got Jesus, you got God. Come on. Come on. The brightness of a glory, and the express image of his person. And not only that, he's upholding everything by the word of his power. When you don't recognize Jesus, what are you holding on to? You're holding on good thoughts and high thinking and a power somewhere, or send up this and send that there. But it's Jesus in the mix. Jesus got to be in the mix, or else the mix is a mess. Jesus got to be in the mix. And I mean, not your emotion, but Jesus. Because Jesus is greater than your emotion. Your emotion will make everything righteous and make Jesus unrighteous. But let God be the truth and every man be a liar. So your right thinking may not be God's way of thinking, because it's emotional. You can fall in love and it'll overshadow correct judgment or moral thinking. But you got a thing of beauty when you make them all line up. Jesus, you in my emotion. And everything I do, I want it to honor you. I want your name to be set above it. That I don't care where I go. No, that's all about Jesus. How you doing it? In Jesus. Who helped you do what Jesus did? Who made it possible? Jesus did. Because the Bible says something else. It's not by power, not by might, not your brilliance, but by my spirit, says the Lord. That's only how it's done. And if you're doing it any other way, you can lose your might and you can lose your power. But you better have Jesus, because at the end of the day, that's all you're gonna have left. Anybody know I'm talking right there? Holding up thing by the brightness of his express image, the word of his power. Now I'm continue to read. When he had by himself purged, paid the price for our sins, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high, having become so much better than angels. You can keep calling them African angels. I'm going to call on the name of Jesus. Because his name is better than angel. That's what my scripture says. It's better than angels. Now, I know they're ministering spirits, but they work for me when I use the name that is better than angels. Does that make sense? My car works for me. I don't care how smartly it's engineered. It can't do nothing until I put the key in it. And if I don't put any gas in it, none of the computers on it will work. Somebody told me once, your car's smarter than you. I said, no, it's not. Because the key in my pocket. The key in my pocket. And I'm still waiting for it to go without me doing something to tell it to go. And he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high, having become so much better than the angels, as he has by inheritance. Jesus has by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. Simply because he's God, he's with God, he's one of the triune spirits of God. He by inheritance. I was back there when they were saying Elohim. I was back there when they said Elohim Shiloh. I was back there when they said Yahweh. I was back there when they said Adonai. But I've obtained a name more excellent than those names through inheritance. Because all of those names were my names. Then finally, at the end of time, and that's where we are, God will say, I'm going to give my name that is greater than any other name that's ever been named for me. That at the name Jesus, every knee must bow. Every tongue must confess that I'm Lord to the glory of God, because I am God. You might be asking, why is this so important? Number one, we find that our God is consistent from beginning to end. What he said in the beginning, he means it at the end. And what he says at the end, it was backed up to the beginning. He's consistent. Number two, he loved us the best. Not only giving us his son, but also giving us his name, Jesus, to use in the earth. That's what's so good about this name. The name in the Old Testament, they couldn't pronounce. So they made it into J-H-V-H. Or they were pointed to it, or they were just not mentioned it. But over in the New Testament, you shall call his name Jesus, because he shall save their people from their sin. And so we get the use of the name. Everywhere the disciples went, they baptized in the name. They raised the dead in the name. They delivered folk with the name, because they were given the use of the name. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, take up your bed and walk. In the name of Jesus, repent and be baptized, every one of you, for the pulling back of sin, in Jesus' name. Come on, come on, come on. Whew. Romans 10 and 13 says, for whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Then Colossians 3:17 says, and you ought to keep this one. And it says, and whatever, everybody say whatever. Whatever. What's the next two words? You do. And what? Whatever. And what? Whatever you do. Not your talk only, but your actions. Indeed, your decisions. Your life choices. Do all in what? Giving thanks to God the Father through him. You can't even thank God unless you do it through Jesus. What are you doing without considering Jesus? When he said, whatever you do, in word or deed, do all in the name of Jesus. Ain't no emotion in that all. Don't even say if you like it. But if you're going to do it in the name of Jesus. Because that's the filter for your choices. That's the filter that helps your decision. It ain't just a bracelet. What would Jesus do? And you snap it and still decide what you want. There is something in the name. What's in the name? There's power in the name of Jesus. There's deliverance in the name. There's an ability to get free from anything through the name. Immediately, the Holy Spirit just carried me to Lazarus' grave. And somebody said, well, the name wasn't used to raise Lazarus from the dead. Well, you know, the name was already alive and walking in front of him. You got the name with you. See, we need to call it because he's not physical with us. But when you bad enough to have the name with you, that's why the name told the dead man in the grave, Lazarus, come forth. It was still the name Jesus. The grown man that was a baby, unborn, that's mama was told, and you will call his name Jesus, that Jesus was alive and walking in the earth. So whatever that name said happened. Take up your bed. Lazarus, come forth. What's in the name? There's power in the name of Jesus. And everything you do, do it in that name. Do it in that name. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the victory we have through Jesus Christ, our Lord. We thank you for our positioning. We thank you for what you've given us to destroy yokes, release bondages. And so in Jesus' name, we pray for healing all over this country. Your name is above the name COVID. You are better than any vaccine. And God, we want you to clear the earth of this thing. I ask it now in Jesus' name. And I tell it to go in Jesus' name. God, we praise you. These are the perilous times that you spoke of. But this isn't the thing that will bring the end. So we rebuke it in Jesus' name. And we thank you. Release wisdom in the earth that religious leaders will return to Bible-centered wisdom. God, we thank you. And we give you the glory. In Jesus' name. Blessings to you again. If you heard this broadcast today, we're praying for you. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. We're praying for you. Surrender your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. His name is far above every name that is named in the earth. Surrender your life. Repeat after me these words of a confession for salvation. Father, in Jesus' name, I surrender my life to you. I repent of sin and give you my heart. I believe today, Jesus, that you were born of a virgin, that you died on a cross, that you were raised from the dead 3 days later. And on that confession, I am saved. to the glory of God. Well, if you prayed that prayer, you are saved today. Find a good Bible believing and teaching church that carries you through scripture and explains it to you. We are in Detroit, Michigan on Military Interracial, 4660 Military Street, Interracial, at the crossroads of Livernois and Michigan Avenue. Write us or call us, the information you'll get at the end of this broadcast. Again, we love you. Have a precious Merry Christmas. Celebrate Jesus. Celebrate Jesus. He is the reason for this season. Blessings to you again. Praise the Lord again. To all of our listeners, we thank God for you. We encourage your financial support of this ministry. Dove Church is good ground. We are here to bless you and know that the Lord will bless your giving. You can use PayPal by going to our website at dovechurch.com/giving, which takes you to our PayPal page. We appreciate your sharing this time with us today. God bless you.